I am concerned about global questions of survival, the threat of war, exploitations of raw materials, population growth, misery for mankind. Hello. On A Plus today, I shall be talking to the young West German whose words those are. She is Petra Kelly, founder member of West Germany's Green Party, which stands for conservation, human rights and decentralisation, but most of all, for the banning of all nuclear weapons and nuclear power. Now, I know why you're here, because we invited you, but why did you accept our invitation?
I think Great Britain is very important in this entire struggle against Pershing and cruise missile. We're an international movement. We live on the solidarity of each other, on the loyalty with each other. And if the European movement does not become stronger and more in solidarity, we would lose our struggle against nuclear warfare.
You see, the British peace movement is operating in parallel with the West German peace movement.
And I find it quite strong here. I find the role of, especially the women, quite strong here. The peace camps outside of Greenham Common. And I find that the British people, in fact, are realizing themselves what a policy Mrs. Thatcher is about to cash in for them. It's a policy of death.
With the arrival or the
arrival of Tridents, with the arrival of cruise missiles, and with the arrival of Pershings in our country.
Now, I should make it quite clear for everybody that it's not our intention today to cross-examine and challenge every single one of Petra's ideas. It's more, in today's programme, an exploration of her new and certainly challenging ideas, and to help us better understand what her movement is all about, and to some extent the equivalent in this country. And also perhaps to help you muster the counter-arguments should you disagree. One other word, for Petra Kelly it's important to understand she doesn't have a conventional political approach. She's not a politician in the conventional sense. For her, I think it's true to say, Petra, you believe that personal is politics.
Yes.
And that
yes.
politics is personal.
Yes, it comes from the personal experience, and we must become experts over our own lives, over our own security, become experts over our own work, and not have it done for us from the top, from soulless bureaucrats and technocrats who don't know what life is all about.
Well, talking about life, I understand that this week you were alarmed to hear that President Reagan is deploying 100 more missiles pointing at the Soviet Union.
Yes.
Now, that is a very hard political reality. How can you, in your rejection of politics, counter that?
Well, it's an utterly insane idea. It's governments like Mr. Reagan's breaking the law for life, and in fact bringing death, because the overkill on both sides is so great already that one more MX rocket or one more SS-20 will not make me deader than dead.
You used a phrase there, overkill on both sides. What does that mean exactly?
It means that the potential of ABC, of atomic, bacteriological and chemical weapons, is already so great we can kill each other 50 and 60 times over. And already to reduce it so we can kill each other only one time would already be a revolution in thinking. And I believe that the way Mr. Reagan is planning not only to point at the Soviet Union, but to point at people in Solidarnosc, these missiles are pointing at people we're supporting. They're pointing at people, women, men and children. They're not pointing at any ideological enemy.
Now, let me widen out your area of belief, because there's only one platform, the anti-nuclear weapons.
Right.
You're generally called the Green Party because you're concerned with the ecology, anti-pollution and so on. Tell me about how you think these things interrelate.
Well, it is all interrelated. Ecology means it's a reconciliation with the planet Earth that has no emergency exit because the planet Earth is limited. It also means ecology, a reconciliation with the people and with one another, also with men and women, reconciliation with children, with the handicapped, with all the exploited people on this earth. And ecology in the wider sense means also that we've only got this one spaceship called the planet Earth, and we better live on it peacefully or else we blow each other to pieces. And ecology in the German sense means also to try to question hierarchy, centralization, living always on the backs of other people, stopping to live like that, and trying to figure out how to get out of the gap between the third world and 16 million children dying every year, and the economic growth series of absolutely insane politicians who ask for 2 or 3% more economic growth.
It's a very new idea, I think, over here, to throw out the idea of growth. We've always lived, since the war certainly, on the whole idea that each year we will produce more, each year our standard of living will rise. But rather than discuss the economics of growth, I'm interested in the way you talk, because then you dealt with probably about 16 or 17 ideas to do with the nature of politicians, the nature of representative democracy, the nature of growth, the nature of nuclear weapons. You always speak so quickly. Why is that? Is there not enough time for you to get everything in?
Well, I think time is running out. I have worked 9 years in Brussels and I have become quicker and quicker in trying to convey my thoughts, because I feel that people have to understand the relationship to the different subjects, whether it be inflation, military budgets or exploitation of women. And the whole time while we're speaking here, there is a war already in order, a war causing misery, causing death, and we're sitting here speaking about it and nothing is happening.
Which war is that?
There's a small war, I would say, going on while the big war is being planned or being planned by accident. The small war, which means the war against women, the war of men against the life, the idea of life. 400,000 people working on destructive material, making weapons. The idea of the third world countries, in fact, all the day, every day exploited. Workers exploited. There is so much small wars going on, and we have apparently lost complete control over how society should grow. And I think growth is very important, but spiritual growth, a growth that will bring more quality to life, that will make less people go into clinics, less people seeking psychosomatic care and help. It has to come back to a self-reliance, a self-help. We have to learn to help ourselves.
Now, you say that to combat the plans for the big war, we should refuse to have cruise missiles, Pershing missiles, Trident, and so on.
How about fuse defense?
Well, I'll get onto this whole question about defense in a moment, but I'm interested in the other wars you've talked about. Now, you have solutions for the big war that's being planned, as you describe it. What do you propose we do to avoid and eradicate the little wars, as you describe them?
Well, we first of all, I think, have to become vulnerable within ourselves. We have to learn to get rid of the picture of the enemy, also within ourselves. We have to change ourselves personally before we can change the world. That is my absolute belief. And that means also that we have to dramatize, not only through words, but through actions, which can be communicated to people, what it is all about. And I believe that the industrial societies, especially Europe, they have a moral commitment, because they have started so many wars, small and big wars, a moral commitment to try to live differently, because the time is running out for the ecological catastrophe or the atomic one. So I think we only have maybe 10 years, maybe even less.
You say that, excuse me, that we have to learn to be vulnerable, each of us as individuals and presumably as societies. Now, is it because you were rather vulnerable as a child? And I don't mean to practice some amateur psychology here, but is it that you had a rather traumatic childhood that you have the kind of independence of views that you have been talking about now? What was your childhood like?
Well, my childhood was very much symbolized by women, my grandmother and my mother, who've lived alone many years, and I have been sensitized by women able to make it on their own. Completely after the war, women, of course, were back into all the positions of power and of power sharing, and I could sense that as a woman I would have to struggle very hard, but that I had to live autonomously and I'd have to live alone to be able to do it. I always wanted to become either a nun or a politician. There seems to be, to me, not much difference between the two, because it means to convert someone or to convert people.
When you say women on their own were getting by, is that now, was that sense sharpened by the fact that your father left your family when you were 4 years old?
Yes, in fact, I'm very happy that I grew out without a father. I didn't have the ideal of a I would say, centralized patriarchal figure. I had lost my father.
That's a phrase that none of us would normally deal in, a centralized patriarchal figure.
But I think most women, they learn as a child and in the family to be subservient to the father and subservient to the idea of he gives the order, he gives the command, even if it's subtle. And they don't learn to be on their own. And then they meet a boyfriend, they meet a husband, and they again give up their own fulfillment, their own life for the husband, for his career. They never learn to fulfill their own mission, their own life. And to be able to do that, you must bring a lot of sacrifices. I've learned that from the discipline in a convent where I went to school, where I was glad to leave it again at 13 and go to the United States, and then I was on my own more or less. And I learned then that I better make it on my own, because I didn't want to share in this very conventional way where men support and help me and I help and support them. I wanted to be a person in my own right, and first to be a person and then to be a woman.
Now, you said your grandmother figured largely as well in the shaping of the Petra Kelly that we now see before us. How? What kind of things did she do with you? What kind of disciplines did she impose
on
you?
Well, she has been 30 years alone, but she has, in the last 10 years, been at most every non-violent direct action with me, in most demonstrations. She's a war widow living on a very small income. She has become quite radical. She reads Bakunin and Rosa Luxemburg at the age of 77, and she's beginning to rethink her life, and I think at age 77 that's quite important. And she's also every single day going through five papers, in fact helping me find all the, let's say, all the contradictions in politics. She's become a totally politicized person, but she has, in the course of this, lost many of her friends because she's so active. She's a so-called Grey Panther.
It's the Grey Panther, of course, because of the colour of their hair,
yes,
and the militancy of the
Black
Panthers.
Militants of the old age movement. And I think old people, elderly people, have so much to teach us, because especially of this war generation that has been through fascism and that, in fact, is helping, even in the Green Party, give us a vision that we have to learn to cope with the generation gap.
Now, even that is a challenging view, because generally speaking, we dismiss and reject the opinions and so on of old people, unless they're aging politicians, in which case we venerate them as having all the wisdom that could possibly be accumulated in one brain. Now, why is that, do you think?
Well, I think we end up becoming again dependent on authorities, and I think that's wrong. I think age brings a lot of dignity, a lot of wisdom. But if age is only bringing authority because you've been a paid politician very well and privileged, then I think it's wrong, just out of the sake of the authority. I think that the idea of also people at their old age as politicians being able to get so much support is wrong. You have to question, what did they really do? Not their words, but what did they really do? Did they change the world? Did they change society? Or did they just live on very good income, on the taxpayers' money? That is, to me, the problem. We should all become politicians. There shouldn't be somebody set aside to learn how to become a politician and then to be privileged all their lives to make politics for others.
Mm. Now, in your veneration of older people and your desiring to benefit from their wisdom, like your grandmother, do you find that in your movement, the Green Party, that you have many people of her age, of the 60s and 70s?
Well, we have an amazing generation situation. In the Green, we have many young people who say no future. The last trial is to try it with the Green Party. And then we have many elderly people who are very committed in their fight against chemical plants, nuclear power plants, who are affected. They usually come to the Green when they're affected, not when they're unaffected. And they are very, very strong people. They, in fact, understand deep down what ecology is all about. And I'm happy we have them. Without them, the Green Party could not be a success.
What interests me about the involvement of older people is that they can retain and muster an enthusiasm and an optimism.
Yes.
Despite a life, especially in Germany, I guess, of real trial, of real difficulty and pain.
Yes. It is also one of the most amazing things when elderly people who are also part of the church movement, part of the very committed Catholic movement, sit down and do nonviolent action with us and also support it because they feel themselves that words and paper is no longer enough.
What kind of hostile reaction do you get? Because I can imagine that when you stood for the local elections in Bavaria, there, in a sense, I suppose that's the heartland of the traditional German right, that you were, in a sense, in the least fertile soil of the entire West German Republic. How
do
people manifest a hostility, and how wide is that hostility?
Well, I've run three times and twice from an urban Bavaria area, now in the regional elections in the blackest area, Bavaria, where Franz Josef Strauß gets 80% of the vote. The hostility of the men was very large against me, even some green men who couldn't understand my openness, who couldn't understand my frankness, and also my personal views. On the other hand, the church, the Catholic Church, the hierarchy, tried very much to upset the campaign, saying we're an anti-democratic party, we're totally subversive. And of course, in Bavaria, there still is a lot of influence by the church, and it's being stifled. All this movement is still being stifled. But we did get an amazing amount of growth in Bavaria, and I'm very happy over the 6.2% I received there. What amazed me was that I found women so much more exploited than I could ever believe in the deep hills of the Alp region. They seem to have no voice of their own. And this has saddened me very much because I couldn't really mobilize them enough.
Could you get through to them at all, do you think?
I got through to young women who are living on farms, who were feeling isolated, but I couldn't get through to a lot who go to the church and vote like their husband votes. There was no way to move them because they have been all their lives used to doing what their husband has told them to do.
Which is exactly what you were talking about earlier, the virtues of your own independent life,
yes,
without a father figure imposing a style of...
And, for example,
living.
To have the right to financial independence, that's one of the best and most important rights, the right to work, the right to an income. This is for women something they must struggle for. It's not even accepted as part of society, that women's right to work and their right to their own income.
I assume by your talking here to me that you're not particularly anti-man as such, but against the male values within society.
I'm against a lot of the male values, but I think emancipation can only be reached with men. Men have to do quite a bit to lose their own privileges and begin losing their own rights, also on the job market. In sexuality, we have to get away from phallocratic sexuality.
And I think what is that?
I think that it's terrible that sexuality in the so-called sexual revolution has become something very consuming. It's become an object and a kind of consuming of sexual.
To be bought and sold.
Yes, to be bought and sold, even in the relationship of marriage. I find that many people who complain of the entire sterility. And I think eroticism, in the deepest sense, the way many women meant it at the beginning of the 19th century, the way Alexandra Kollontai meant it, means that eroticism has to be a unity of mind, of spirit, and of body. And only when that is there can there be true sexuality. That's why I think the sexual revolution has done nothing except made women more accessible to men. It's done absolutely nothing. It has not given women any more rights. It's given men more rights.
You think there should have been a more two-way process, that
yes,
women should have become on a more level plane, shall we say, with men, but men also
yes,
should have emphasized or brought out more the feminine or more vulnerable.
The more
side
feminine
of
qualities. I think men and women have both masculine and feminine qualities, but that men should learn to live with their emotion, be able to live with their tears, and women should also learn to live with more rationality. They should, in fact, become experts over weapons, over foreign policy, and there must be a transcendence of the two. They must one day really come together, otherwise the problem of the sexes will never be solved.
This is a very revolutionary attitude, because politics normally isn't conducted with those kind of ideas in mind. It's very highly specialised, very narrow in its direction and its outlook. Aren't you frightening some of the West German politicians?
I'm noticing they become very insecure because they expect me to be only emotional or only hysteric. They expect me to perhaps take a lesbian position, which I'm not. And then they expect me to be quite sad over my sister's death, and they try to mingle it all, but they never see that I'm really concerned. Once they realize that I'm trying to take them on with their own issues, then I realize that they're very insecure and frightened.
You mentioned your sister's death there. She died age 10, as we said in the introduction to the program. But wasn't it the nature of her death that made you more concerned about the whole impact of nuclear power, of nuclear matters, of radiation and so on?
Yes, well, she's in fact the key point in my life, because she died after 3 years of radiation experience of an eye sarcoma. She lost her eye, she was operated, she was nearly a Hiroshima victim, she lost her hair, nearly lost her ear, and she was radiated every day in a radiation clinic, and it was a time for me to really begin asking, what crime is the radiation industry, civilian and military and medical uses, committing? And it is committing a crime every day, because radiation doses at whatever level can be dangerous. And she died a radiation death. She was overburned. And her death has caused me to ask that question, why is every fourth person in Europe dying of cancer? What, in fact, have we done with politics to make that an acceptable fact? Why can we not begin questioning even the idea, how can man and womankind live like this, the fact that they're going to die every third and fourth person? And I feel a one-woman lobby sometimes against the medical uses, against the civilian uses and the military uses, because the two experiences in my life, my sister's death and Hiroshima and Nagasaki, they have made me quite clear that I must do as much as I can to try to open up this terrible conspiracy.
Now, you work 18 hours a day in doing as much as you can. Don't you find there is a terrible toll to be paid personally for your politics?
Well, as we have no paid politician, and I think that's good so, I do have to keep my job in Brussels, and I've done that for 9.5 years. Now I've taken an unpaid leave, because there are certain times where you cannot do it anymore when you're electioneering. On the other hand, I find that a short qualitative life is much better than a long life that is of no quality and of no consequence. And I've been often very ill, so in fact that has given me a lot of strings to go on. But the exploitation I have felt, and the sense of utter hopelessness within the EEC in Brussels, the utter idiocy of some of the policies and corruption, has made me very strong, and it's quite logical I'm with the Green Party now.
Now, all the way through this past 15 minutes or so that we've been talking, you've been absolutely straight down the line. Usually when we talk to politicians, they're hedging this way and hedging that way. There's been no hint of compromise, no hint of diluting your ideas. But what is going to happen if, when next March in the national elections in West Germany, you, the Green Party, as expected, hold the balance of power? You're then going to be dealing with very professional, very experienced wheelers and dealers of power who will be offering you compromises. Won't you then be forced to compromise?
There are certain subjects in life, the right to health, to peace, and to the right not to be hurt in any way physically, that are not negotiable. We will never negotiate those. That is to say that we will never make any politics of compromise on life and death questions. We will talk about others, but we will not do societal change just through the parliament. Our hope is to change Europe and to change society and to change the system structurally and non-violently on the street. And the parliament is just part of the strategy. It's a place where you can also make your goals known. But sharing power or becoming a green minister has nothing to do with societal change. So we will never ever tolerate a government that will continue making policies of death. Never.
Now, I can see that's the only attitude you can adopt, but will it really happen that way? Will the SPD, a large and well-established strong party in West Germany, say, okay, Petra, yeah, we give in, you're right? It's not going to happen like this.
I doubt it very much, but what could happen is that Mr. Vogel, the candidate of the SPD, will only become chancellor with the votes of the Green, but he will only get those votes if he immediately guarantees no deployment and absolutely no use of nuclear power. And of course, if these two questions are solved, then we can go on speaking. But this speaking must be done in full public. Negotiations will only be in full public. And I think the SPD has used us tactically, has tried to misuse us, and socialists, governments or social democratic policies have failed because they have used the tools of capitalism. They're using gross societies, they're using exploitation, and with such a party I don't see much difference.
Now, you said the two conditions on which you might be able to enter into a coalition deal...
No, to tolerate a minority government.
To tolerate a minority government and not immediately use your votes to kick them out, were the dismantlement of any nuclear bases within West Germany. Now...
And also a way out of the military blocs, meaning we would like to see a way in which the SPD tries to leave not only NATO, but finds a policy to leave both military blocs, also for the East, but we do the first step first.
Does that mean, to raise the question that came up earlier, that you are against defence? Of course, the implication of that question is that your enemies would say that you are a Soviet agent, really, because you're making it possible for the Soviet Union to dictate the terms of Europe's future.
I'm against a form of defence that causes atomic holocaust. I'm against any weapon that causes more insecurity. Thus, I'm against defence, and I mean it in a different way. I mean it, I believe in this democracy. I believe in my rights of speech, my rights of assembly, my rights of non-violent action. And if I believe in those rights, I cannot be blackmailed politically or militarily by any tank. I think of the tradition of Gandhi and of Martin Luther King, and I'm strengthened by what they have done, because they have tried to change parliaments, they have tried to change court decisions, and they had an effect. And I believe if there's any aggressor from the outside, this German society must learn to do social defense, must defend its democratic ideals, not its borders, because all they will be left if they militarily defend themselves is an atomic wasteland. And I'd rather be dead than be a mass murderer.
Yes, so you're not prepared to kill or be party to a society that kills. Are you surprised by the success and the response, perhaps is a better word, the response to your movement that has grown over the past 3 or 4 years?
Well, we have
nothing has happened over here or anywhere else in Europe or in the Western world.
Well, there are parties growing, of course, Green Party. The Ecology Party in Great Britain has many difficulties, but I hope it also grows. But the Green movement came out of the outer parliamentary ecological movement, and there was an arm, a parliamentary arm, founded in 79. Our first results in 79 was 3.2%, nearly a million votes, were very good in the European elections. I'm amazed that we could grow so much with so many political positions coming together on a consensus issue. And I find it in Germany, it's a revolution, because it's questioning the idea of authority, of obedience. It's questioning the way politics are made. It's questioning the role of a minister who sits in certain companies sharing votes to put certain projects through, like an extension of an airport. And it's questioning politics, the way politics is being done, always above people and for them, but not with them. And I think the Green Party can only survive, in fact, as an historical experiment, if it wages itself and risks itself, meaning that civil disobedience, as Thoreau has always said, must be part of democracy to strengthen democracy. And that is a belief that we have, and we must also show it in the year of the deployment. This is our very big historical test. Can we prevent non-violently the deployment of these coming missiles?
Now that, of course, is the aspect that unifies the West German movement with the whole European-wide peace movement, the deployment of American missiles throughout this part of the continent. What are your observations of the strength and the possible impact of the movement over here?
I think the strength is quite a bit in a historical tradition, from the Russell campaign all the way to the women at Greenham Common, that they are risking in small direct action themselves going to prison for it, that also there is, thank God, a very fantastic initiative, the nuclear-free zones in Wales, the many communes and localities that have inspired us in Nuremberg and in Tübingen to do the same. And I also think the tradition of the Aldermaston marches, of the exhibition, demonstrations at the war exhibitions, at the different weapons exports exhibitions, have given us hope that here there is also a belief in this nonviolence, and also the belief in a bloc-free movement, not loyal to Warsaw, not loyal to NATO, but loyal to each other. The Bertrand Russell movement, the END and CND movement are a bloc-free movement. That is the only hope we have. We have to be the third force moving through the two blocs and showing that we're a force of our own, but we're a spiritual force. We have nothing to do with these weapons.
I'm glad you used the word spiritual. We had another conversation on this program 2 or 3 weeks ago, where we were shy of using the word spiritual, but it does sum up so much of what we feel and what we feel we can become. And so I thank you for the use of that word. It reinforces its importance, I think. Petra, for the time being, we'll leave it at that.